big questions that we continuously debate within our community is, what role does high quality dairy, grass-fed dairy, have in an optimal human diet? And the reason why this is a big question is that even though dairy is a relative newcomer to the human diet, right? Animal husbandry came with the agricultural revolution 10 to 12,000 years ago. It's a very nutrient-dense food. Grass-fed dairy is high in some really key nutrients, a lot of minerals that are important for skeletal health, muscular health, and fat-soluble vitamins A, D, and K2, which are not only critical for bone health and connective tissue health, but also immune health. So these are nutrients that have major roles to play in mitigating and preventing chronic disease. The proteins in milk can be typically very easily digested, and whey includes all of the precursors for glutathione production, which is one of our body's main antioxidant enzymes. So there's some really intense benefits to grass-fed dairy, at least nutritionally. Now there's also some concerning correlations in the medical literature. So we also see with industrially produced dairy that perhaps there's a link to diabetes and obesity and cardiovascular disease. And these are reasons why dairy is not a uniformly endorsed food, because there's pros and cons. These sensitivity, intolerance, and allergy rates are quite high, and that goes beyond lactose intolerance. But we know that the allergy rates are maybe a couple percent, 2 to 4%, depending on the age group, higher in younger kids. But also that the intolerance rate, and there's not very many great studies looking at food intolerance rates in the general population, but it seems to be higher than other foods. So we know, for example, in studies looking at people with irritable bowel syndrome, that certainly that population has a very high proportion of people who are intolerant. So they're making IgG antibodies against dairy proteins. And that number is something like 90%. So it's a very, very high rate. How well that translates to people who don't have GI symptoms, we don't know. We don't have that information. But what is really interesting and worth talking about as we discuss the pros and cons and really say, look, this is a good food, but maybe eliminate it initially, right? Have your super clean elimination period as you first adopt the paleo diet, and then try adding quality dairy back in. See what your individual tolerance is, because if you aren't sensitive, if you don't have an intolerance to it, there's some really compelling nutrition. But beyond that sort of argument for inclusion or exclusion of high quality dairy within our diets, beyond that is this differentiation between A1 beta casein dairy and A2 beta casein dairy. So this is a slightly different variation of the beta casein molecule. And what's fascinating is this collection of studies that show maybe we should be a little bit concerned about dairy in adults. You know, there's certainly evidence that kids up to age 5 really do benefit from dairy in their diets. But beyond that, you know, when you look at adults, there's some reasons to be concerned. It really looks as though all of those concerning correlations and statistical relationships that we see in the scientific studies really only apply to A1 beta casein dairy. A2 beta casein doesn't seem to be metabolized into the same types of molecules. The downstream effects are quite different. So the metabolites of consuming dairy that might be increasing risk of cardiovascular disease or even increasing risk of cancer, those are metabolites of A1 beta casein, not A2 beta casein. So then that flips this whole argument over, because not only are we sort of saying, well, dairy's a nutritious food if you tolerate it, but then we're also saying A2 dairy not only seems to have lower allergy rates, so you have a higher chance of tolerating it, but also this pros and cons, you know, balancing equation suddenly goes from, see how you do. We can't really make a clear distinction on whether or not this food has enough pros to balance out the cons. But we start to go like, whoa, look at all these pros, this is amazing, not very many cons, right? The balance tips in favor of A2 dairy. And that's one of the reasons why, you know, we've started incorporating a lot more A2 dairy products into our, you know, my family's diets, other than my 7-year-old, who is just as sensitive to A2 as A1. The rest of us do really, really well on A2 dairy. And what we're choosing, there's lots of options, but we've been choosing goat milk dairy because I have fallen in love with the Mount Capra products. So if you're not familiar with Mount Capra, it's grass-fed goat milk products, and they have a huge spectrum. So from just straight powdered goat milk or powdered goat cream, to this is one of my favorites. You can see the jar is almost empty. This is goat milk ghee. It has a really unique taste. It's really, really high in medium chain triglycerides, so they're the same beneficial sort of short saturated fats that are in coconut oil that are also in goat ghee. Super, super high in fat-soluble vitamins, and this is what I put in my coffee in the morning. But they also have a huge collection of goat milk protein powders. So for so many of us who tend to be rushed and need to be able to have that instant throw a bunch of things in the blender type breakfasts, these are a great solution, and they retain a lot of the nutrition because a lot of them, so this one is one of my favorites, Capratine, is a whole protein. So it's not an isolated whey. So when you have the whole protein, you retain a lot of the nutrients that in addition to just the protein. What's really unique about this particular goat milk protein is that the milk is fermented before the protein is isolated. So it's partially digested basically by bacteria. So just like many people will do better with fermented dairy products, right? So they'll be fine with a long fermented yogurt or a kefir, because as the bacteria digest the protein, it breaks it up and unravels it. So it becomes less antigenic, which means you have a lower probability of having an intolerance or an allergic reaction to it. And that, of course, is going to be individual, but a lot of people do really, really well with fermented dairy, even if they don't do well with non-fermented dairy. So this protein is lacto-fermented before being turned into a powder. So I think this is a really unique protein, and this is what we have been using in my house as a protein powder for smoothies. And this is another one I wanted to show you. It's called the Capra Mineral Whey. This is actually a mineral supplement. So even though it's whey protein based, it doesn't have a ton of protein, certainly not protein to carbohydrate ratio, but it's concentrating the minerals that are in goat milk, which are a lot of bone health minerals, right? Like calcium, and it's concentrating them into a powder that you can use as a supplement. So another little nutrient boost to add to smoothies, and another Mount Capra product that we've come to use in this house quite frequently. They have a huge collection of products, and I really have loved everything that I've tried of theirs. So I just wanted to highlight them as an option if you are thinking about maybe introducing some A2 beta casein grass-fed dairy into your diet to take advantage of the nutrient value that that food has while also trying to minimize the likelihood of adverse effects. Mount Capra is a great place to start.